that was accidentally a great introduction to civil servants. If you know we do our jobs well, you never hear about it. If we do it terribly, something, something, something. If you ever want to feel humbled, then try Googling what you do and seeing that the first answer is how terrible you are. So yeah, I'm not here today to do anything about Hampshire Hospital Trust or any of my other affiliations. I'm here for my last job, which was heading up the secretariat for the aforementioned stupidly named Scientific Pandemic Influenza Group and Modelling Operational, who you can see looking beautiful at the bottom there, alongside our three co-chairs, Graham Medley, Duncan Camp, and Andrew Lippin. So Spine reported back to the stage, who then reported to the Spine Fellows at the top and back to the Cabinet Office. You probably don't know what a secretariat is. I didn't know, I still don't really know, but if my friends ask me what I do for a job, or ask me rather, I tend to say I can't wait. So I'm probably the only person in the country who has both a PhD in infectious modelling and 7 or 8 years coming into the pandemic of policy analysis experience, which turned out to be quite useful combination of skills. So we did everything that wasn't the modelling itself. So firstly, setting the agenda, working out how it is that modelling can be helpful for that next policy decision, often trying to predict the next policy decision before the policy makers did. Spent a lot of time telling people, no, we can't do this. We were asked repeatedly to model things which were utter waste of time, like the famous one was opening nail bars. What on earth is modelling going to make sense about the use of opening nail bars in the pandemic? So we send out a long email demanding a huge amount of work of our academics on a Friday. Wednesday morning, they'd send in a bunch of really long, complicated math papers. We would work our way through them very quickly, trying to pick out a focus that asking the right questions, and say that's exactly the right way of describing it. Asking the right questions, working out if the models are robust, and picking out the policy relevant conclusions. We then hold the meeting on SIAM, kick the tyres, work out what the consensus of the group was. Then I would spend my Wednesday afternoon, Wednesday evening, Wednesday night, frantically writing up one of those consensus statements that Rachel showed, which was the official IMO output. I think you saw in the papers the government's scientific advice to say X or Y. It tended to be something that I would write about 11 o'clock at night, having not slept for 6 or 7 months. Then Thursday we'd have the stage meetings, and then on either the next Friday or the week after we would be publishing the papers. So yeah, quite a lot of different things. So I wrote a great presentation about all the challenges we faced, and then some top tips for science communication. Turns out I don't have an hour, I only have 20 minutes, so I'm only going to give you the challenges. But conveniently, yesterday everyone really covered all of the tips I was going to give anyway, so that would have been a waste of time. Hannah said that we only have a hook for this, so my hook is that I've subtly, very subtly, hidden some song titles out of this presentation, mostly for my own entertainment. And physics, you know, the morning after the conference dinner, you know, properly get back and thought I'd have a bit of a competition. So can you put your hand up, please, if you like cardio tape? Okay, I've hidden Cardi B title in this, and if anyone spots it, you need to shout Cardi B. And there is the best prize you can ever possibly imagine. Yeah, 50p for the top. So if you don't spot it, then this is mine. But I think they're very subtle, these song titles. You're probably not going to spot one, even if you try your hardest. Alright, so we heard yesterday about segmenting audiences and the challenges of communicating to different people at the same time. And this was probably our most difficult challenge. I tended to think of our audience on 5 different fronts. Firstly, of course, on the work that's actually stage, it has to be scientifically accurate and rigorous and correct. then as soon as the meeting was over, you knew that what you were writing was being read by the advisors to the top ministers. And each of them had their own style. One of those four people really liked detail and wanted every single parameter to be put in your consensus statement, which meant that we then had to make them a lot longer than they might otherwise. One of them preferred a couple of slides with one or two graphs at most, which is quite a challenge when you're dealing with something with orders of magnitude but different, two different camera combinations. The trick we found with politicians is, again, something I was mentioning yesterday about how people like to feel smart. You can't just make some statements about what they do and how a minister. You have to persuade them that they come up with a solution themselves. Which is fun. You know who number three is. I'll talk a little bit more about the media later, but the main thing here is to point out that we have to be really careful with our language. There were some fantastic journalists out there, but there were some on the political side who would pick up on any stray language, and that would be the headline. So there was a lot of effort went into making sure the pages were completely smooth and we weren't accidentally saying something we weren't intending to say. Next up is the general public. I think I was right about her mum. I've never met her mum, but my mum is who I always pictured when I was writing these documents as well. Again, smart woman who knows nothing about maths and nothing about the computer model. But there was a vast deal of interest in our work. One of the papers I read got 160,000 unique downloads, which is ridiculous for a government paper. And then finally, you got the civil servants who then would turn the high level strategy of politics into the low level detail. Particular challenge there was the amount of churn in government meant that you weren't dealing with the same people every day because they were certainly the same effective student model. Another fun one. So everyone wanted infectious disease modeling to be a crystal ball. I would love to have a crystal ball, but what modeling actually does is it reflects yourself, reflects the viewer back to themselves, which is kind of a corpus analogy. Modeling, to my mind, could be four things. Firstly, it could give an explanation of where you are at a given time. So, at the start of the pandemic, that was taking tiny scraps of evidence. You'll have one exported case from China to Vietnam. You come up with an estimate of how many cases were actually in China at that time. Or coming up with the R number each week that we published, or the growth rate. Secondly, it is good at extrapolating current trends over a short time period to say, you know, where you could be if you go back to our ministers. Thirdly, it gives good orders of magnitude. It's not particularly exactly where you're going to go, but you can sometimes put upper and lower bounds on what could happen. And finally, I think most importantly, is actually the sensitivity analyses in the results that we have. We would always get the models to run bajillions or permutations of parameter bands in their work. And the purpose of that was to work out which parameters the models are most sensitive to. Once you know that, you know what the future of the pandemic is most dependent on. You can then work out which of them the government can control, which of them they can't. And that really is the way to work out the policy implications of the model. So these are the things you can control, and therefore this is what you might want to do, Minister, if you want to keep things down. Do you remember this? Do you remember the front of New York Times and Sex Life being on the front of the paper? It's probably the only time you're ever going to see a math professor Sex Life on the front of the paper after the term. So the reason I've got this up is just to remind ourselves of quite how much pressure we really were under doing this. You would have work which, you know, usually would be a whole page sheet that the modeler would do over the course of the weekend, and we would be writing up these documents in ridiculous time scales. We certainly didn't get everything right. So we've been relentlessly for a couple of years, knowing that the consequences of what we did could be huge, you know, for better or worse. We're making a big difference to a lot of policies which affect every single person in the country. So that made the process that much harder. And of course, we were going through this ourselves. You know, I never had an assignment quite as exciting as this. But, you know, we were all trying to find toilet paper or homeschooling kids or, you know, doing this thing which was horrific for everyone to be living on top of the baby. And this is about the reasonable worst case. So the reasonable worst case is what government uses for planning for agencies. And that's kind of defined as the situation which was so bad that you should plan for it. It could get worse, but if it was worse, it's so unlikely that it's not really worth planning for. That's pretty poorly said. What I'm saying is, if you're trying to work on any body bags you need, how much space to talk to, how many ventilators you need, how many antivirals, it's what we call the reasonable worst case that you would plan on. So if you have awesome body bags for the reasonable worst case, then you should be able to cover most eventualities. And very early on, Chris Wickie said something. He's always said very simple things. He pointed out that in climate science, whenever they have a worst case or pessimistic scenario that they put out in the world, if that didn't occur, then there would be a section of the population for whom that would entirely invalidate any work that they have done. And once we had started putting on our documents in the public domain, we were in a proper bind. We needed to make these reasonable worst case plans now, because government needed them, but we also knew that they would get passed when we put them out there. You can just back to the bottom. Tokyo 2020 could be postponed. How naive you were at that time. I said I'd come back to the media. There were some fantastic science journalists out there, some but not all of them at the time. But certain sections of the media and of government, for better or worse, decided that they would be keen on misinterpreting what we said. Particular newspaper, whose name I won't say, I think, had 11 collections about one thing or another in the results. So it's the first time I think that any of us have been in a really political environment. There are plenty of times, I think, to say that when you work in policy that you may not agree with, it's very different when you are being directly criticised for what you are doing. When you know that some people continue to misinterpret what you say. That's not to say you didn't get things wrong, you absolutely got things wrong, but it's less than some people you might recognize this guy. The Halloween weekend in 2020, I was moving back, so I had no internet for 3 whole days. My laptop was in the box. I literally could not work if I tried. The Saturday morning, I checked the news first thing in my completely empty flat and saw this was the top story on the YouTube headline. Someone had leaked from the Lower Kingston some draft that had been a stage meeting, but hadn't actually featured in stage meetings, they had been withdrawn before the meeting had happened. And they were extrapolations of the current trend, and that's all they were. But they were put in the public domain unplanned, with no qualification, with no contact. And over the course of that weekend, we ended up, on the basis of this morning, going into the second lockdown. I don't know who leaked these slides, but 2 weeks later, one coming was picked up the government. It's really hard to give context to modelling when it appears like this. Thankfully, it didn't happen too many times, but there were certainly a few occasions, one in particular when my head office round to ask me what it is that he was having heard that morning about one apprentice that he was considering. With his phone conversations, I didn't know either. So it kind of part of the bigger picture. When our communication worked well, it was when we had three or four groups modeling the same thing. We released that alongside a consensus statement. We have a press briefing. We have all a bunch of live to take that we give to our press office. And then you have Chris and Patrick starting up a conversation and talking about this thing. One difficulty on our side is that we only had one medium ourselves as citizens. We only had those consensus statements that we've already heard about. We weren't talking directly on TV. And some of our academics did a great job. They went on and explained the concept of the nation, not just by modeling, but the pandemic as a whole. And you know, that was fantastic, and I'm really grateful that they did it. But they did occasionally say things that weren't necessarily the consensus of the committee. And there was always blurring of lines between what they were saying and what the committee was saying, which, again, makes life a little more difficult. So, net positive, I think it's great that they did this, but they did work some difficulties. My particular highlight was being told for a panel on the documentary. One of our committee companies that engaged us on Wikipedia in the early days of the pandemic, which was technically true, but only because that's where the World Health Organization had been putting it. But that was a whole new cycle of trying to explain that no, that wasn't the UK data that this is not the virus. And I'm not sure if this is in bad taste. Let's assume it isn't in bad taste. We all have opinions about this. And as someone who's a sort of former civil servant, I don't have anything. But especially someone who's at the same school as her, and she spent most of her electoral campaign saying how awful the school was. But what was it like day four or something of her big new job that the Queen died? And suddenly she was switching to the global stage, doing something that no one had done for 70 years. And she, you know, did not know what she was doing. She had a new job. We've all had new jobs. We were all terrible at the start of the new job, and then got back as time went on. And arguably, we weren't at our most important in the early stages of the pandemic. And no matter how hard you prepare, you know, you can't be ready for that. You can't actually see what it's going to be. We got vastly better and better at our processes, and how it works, how things went on. But you can only do 30, 20, 21. When I think back at what went back well, went badly, it's just in the case of reminding myself, you know, you can't have that insight. You know, you can't be 30, 20, 22 levels of finishing in 30, 20, 20. So no kind of refunds. $145 million streams that has had on Spotify after this morning, so I'm a bit ashamed of it. Bunch of lessons that I'm not going to use. And finally, this sums up my two main interests of tickets and infectious disease modeling, which I now bought this car for you to put on my ancestor's channel when I'm at home. So, yeah, thank you very much, everyone. Thank you.
Like so many talks at this conference, you know, we've got people who should go for now. But we do have a couple of minutes before coffee break, so a couple of questions. A gentleman in the second
row looks vaguely familiar. Thank you.
we did actually put out quite a lot of work that wasn't possible. I think in an ideal world, you would have an internal setting using the worst case only. To say it was needed, but if it was only internally facing, that would stop some of the communication systems that were supposed to be doing it at some point. I definitely think this is one thing where we can get a better place. I think and hope that as part of the inquiry, that we're able to use the case will be able to be considered. It was up to 2009. I think be friends is the right phrase. Definitely putting out a range of different scenarios is something we've had to do. If there's some way that they could all be looked at, our friends in Denmark, the Denmark Telegraph, as well as just the worst case that I'm going to do.
Another question there.
Do you
want to?
A couple of years ago, maybe 5 or 10, there was an article in Nature, I think, which quantified how numerical weather prediction improved and goes wrong, goes right, over decades.
Yeah.
And the satellite that can you make a could you make or has the quantification been done how the modeling improved? I recall, I thought that would be very nice to see, and also maybe to see what items maybe got a little jump, right? I mean, in mostly in numerical prediction, weather prediction is just work. It goes very slowly, but there are some jumps. So has that been done, and can that be done in the modeling of COVID?
It's an interesting analogy as weather forecasting. I think infectious disease modeling is kind of where weather forecasting was maybe 50 years or so ago. I think in many ways it has some, I mean, it's obviously developed a lot since 1924, but it's not come on orders of magnitude like weather forecasting has.
No, but you do see also some initial increases in from the 55 or 50 to 65. You see that. That's the nice. Of course, they have a longer overview. And data assimilation, just like in this modeling, is crucial. Without data, you're dead.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? So there are analogies. But I think it would be nice. But you might want to read it and see if you can actually quantify it. And I think that would be interesting.
One thing that we did is what we call our medium-term projections, which is simply extrapolations of the current trajectory, and we'd use a statistical combination to take a bunch of different models of those and put out our consensus, which is a statistical consensus in that case, rather than a scenario-driven consensus. And Ronnie Bowman at DSCR does some great work quantifying the accuracy of those. The challenge we're faced with that is if you're extrapolating 3 weeks in advance, if you then introduce a new policy on day two, then you know your projections are going to be wrong. Or if Chris Wheatie stands up and tells people to be very careful over Christmas and only, you know, prioritise one thing, that's the equivalent of Michael Fish changing the weather by making his forecast. So, yes, I hope a lot of the academics out there are doing a lot of the work reviewing about what did and didn't work on that front, because I think there's a lot of need for that, certainly.
Fantastic. Okay, I'm sorry, I am again going to cut because we are now eating it too.